Considered the greatest team in school history, today we welcome back our 1996 champions to the campus to say thank you for an unbelievable year.
Who's the better man? Who has the most heart? Who's gonna fight? Who's gonna lay on the line?
Roy Pyatt.
We were one of those teams that did something that nobody thought we could do.
We didn't realize it at the time, and I think it, after you get out of it, you really start understanding what it means.
Coach Williams, post-game in the locker room, told all the guys, said, you really have no idea what you've accomplished here, that this will be a part of your identity for the rest of your lives.
Who are these guys, and do they deserve to be here, and what did they do to get here?
We wanted to be a big name. That's what we wanted to be.
It's funny how teams catch fire, but that team, about the middle of the year, caught fire, started playing well, were playing good going into the SEC tournament down in New Orleans, played it in the Superdome. And we're just incredible in the Dome. Beat Auburn, beat Georgia.
That particular game, it was such a huge game for us because Kentucky was the best team in the country.
The MSU Bulldogs had all the odds against them today against Kentucky. For one, the Bulldogs had never won an SEC tournament title before. And number two, they were playing the Wildcats, one of the toughest teams in the nation.
I remember the press conference before that championship game at the SEC tournament. And I foolishly asked Coach Williams, well, this game will let you know where you stand going into the NCAA tournament. And he shot me a look and made it very clear to me that this was not a barometer game or a measuring stick game, that they were there to play Kentucky and win the game, and that they were going to win the game.
I'm very proud of this team. They're a group of guys that's improved as the year's gone on. The seniors have shown us great leadership.
So I think at that moment in time, he knew exactly what he had. We just didn't quite see it yet until the next day when they put it on Kentucky.
Dante Jones was the guy. He unleashed an offensive arsenal that stunned the Wildcats and the Superdome crowd. Double clutch dunks, three-pointers, fadeaways, turnarounds, it just didn't matter. Whatever Dante threw up went in.
I'll never forget, they were beating Kentucky by about 10 points in the second half, and it had gotten to about 5 minutes to go, and I look over and Rick Pitino's over there with his head down, and I knew it was all over with. He knew he wasn't going to win that day, so that was pretty special.
The ball game is over. You can wrap it in maroon and white. Mississippi State Bulldogs are the champions of the Southeastern Conference.
To beat that Kentucky team, as good as they were, it was, and I had not had a lot of success as a coach in the SEC tournament either, really. So it was a big deal for us. And to do it in the Superdome in front of that many people, and you see those Kentucky people leaving early.
There was a t-shirt seller out there, and he had stacks and stacks of blue and white t-shirts that said Kentucky SEC Champions on it. And I heard him saying to the other guy, he said, what are we going to do with all these t-shirts?
For us to beat that team was certainly a major milestone in the history of our university.
That was a great experience in the Superdome and set up what was to come, and I'm not sure we understood how special what was going to happen after this.
When I was a little kid, I used to go to the SEC tournament and just dream of playing in it, much less winning. It's the greatest feeling in the world. I've never felt anything like it.
I never imagined nothing like this, man. I mean, even at the start of the season, everybody set goals for themselves. We set goals to be SEC champion. But we never, you wanted to come true, but you really don't know if it's going to come true or not. And now that it has come true, man, it's unbelievable.
I'm Richard Williams. I was the head basketball coach at Mississippi State from 1986 until 1998. People tell me all the time, or I get introduced all the time as the coach that took Mississippi State to the Final Four, and I always like to refer to the coach whose players took him to the Final Four.
For the Mississippi State basketball team, nothing ever seems to come easy. Tonight, the Bulldogs battle Virginia Commonwealth in the first round of the NCAA tournament.
My name is Chris Latimer. In 1996, when the Bulldogs made their run to the Final Four, I was a WCBI sports anchor. they played so well against Kentucky, we worried that they would have a little bit of a letdown in the first or second round of the NCAA tournament, but they got a great draw in that UCLA was knocked out early.
Mark Rogers, I was at WCBI from 1994, sports reporter and anchor, and also a sports director from 1995 to 2000. They had all the makings of a really good team. Eric Dampier, Dante Jones, future NBA first-round picks, Daryl Wilson. We knew it was going to be a really good team.
The Dogs used tenacious defense and clutch shooting down the stretch to get out an ugly win over the Rams 58-51.
I'm Jim Ellis, and I was with the basketball team as a broadcaster. We played VCU in the first ball game and beat them 7 or 8 points, and it was a pretty good ball game. And I didn't think we played great, but we won the ball game.
My name is Daryl Wilson, and on our 96-pound 14, my role was to put the ball in the hole. That first game is the hardest game. You know, we have played all season, but yet still, that first tournament game is the hardest one, because you know, you want to get that win, because you lose or go home. So that was critical. We almost fumbled that game, but we worked it out. Basketball guys were great that day, and it led to a little streak we ran off.
I would like to say to my assistant coaches, Rick Stansberry, Greg Carter, Owen Miller, George Brooks, they deserve the credit because they did a magnificent job putting together a game plan in one day.
So far, Princeton has been the Cinderella story of this NCAA tournament. The Tigers shocked UCLA 43-41 last night by using a series of back screens and cuts that left basketball purists all over the country smiling. But not MSU head coach Richard Williams. His Bulldogs have to play Princeton in the second round.
Instead of playing UCLA, they got Princeton, who was really overmatched, regardless of the style that Princeton played. So State won that game by about 20.
You know, beating Princeton was a big deal because they were supposed to be the scholars and they were supposed to outsmart us. And people don't realize how smart a team we had. We really were a smart basketball team.
Princeton scored just 3 baskets in the first 10 minutes. MSU runs away with this one, 63-41. The Bulldogs have won 24 games on the year to tie a school record. They're going to the Sweet 16.
Our goal was to get back to where we were last year. Now our goal is to change. We want to go as far as we can go now. I mean, and we realize what kind of talent we got on this team and how well we're playing right now. We think we can go a whole lot further than just a 16.
Well, they're very good. You know, they're the best team in what's supposed to be the best league in the country, but we're in the Sweet 16. We're looking forward to the opportunity to play another good team.
It was written that after our last home game, after Daryl Wilson's last home game, that the head coach cried. The head coach did cry, and he's going to cry more than that when Daryl leaves here. My favorite ever, Daryl Wilson.
In terms of the heart and soul of that team, emotionally and spiritually, that was in no question Daryl Wilson. That guy, he was the leader. He was the guy that they all looked to. And on the court, he was just a cold-blooded assassin.
I didn't have any idea at that time the heart that Daryl Wilson had and the competitive spirit that he had and what a winner he was and how coachable he was. Because he was one of the most coachable players that I've ever been around. He didn't always agree with everything I told him, but he tried to do it. And so you take all of that, put all that together, his ability to make baskets, his coachability, his competitiveness. He's certainly one of the best, if not the best, that I've ever been around as far as a Mississippi State basketball player.
I think our fans will always look back on Daryl Wilson as one of the favorites to ever wear the maroon and white.
My memory of Daryl Wilson, well, there's a couple of memories. The first is watching him in practice and watching him just not miss a shot. And so in a game, we expected every shot that he put up to go in because he didn't miss in practice.
We played our best at practice. If you want to see the Bulldogs get after it, come sit in at a practice. Because we got after it, really, really got after it. So getting after it that hard at practice, it translates to the game. So when you play, the game's supposed to be easy. That's how we looked at it.
I thought the only way we would be able to compete was to be tougher than those teams and play harder than those teams. And our practices were brutal. I mean, they really were. It was hard. And for those guys to go through a 3-year career, a 4-year career, and put up with what I put them through, the games were easier for them because there was no way the game could be as hard or harder than what we put them through at practice. Because I'm talking the mental part of it, the physical part of it, and we challenged them every day in practice.
A guy that's become a fan favorite very quickly, Dante Jones.
Fun-loving, carefree, loves his teammates, has fun with his coaches, just a jokester and never shuts up. We tell him all the time, I think he talks while he's asleep.
Dante Jones was just a big personality, dynamic guy. He was a walking soundbite.
And then we come out and responded pretty well, and we're playing, and we get to stay the weekend now.
It's good. I mean, this is what I came to Mississippi State for. I have a chance, you know, to probably play for a national championship, and we're getting closer and closer to that goal.
Well, we were playing the way we wanted to play, and everything was just going our way. We got out ahead of them. I mean, if we can keep doing that, man, it's going to be a fun rest of the season.
Big smile, good-looking guy. Every sports reporter wanted to talk to Dante Jones before and after the game, and anytime we could grab him, because he always had something to say with a big grin on his face, and he just exuded confidence and maybe a little bit of arrogance.
And it took Dante a little while to fit in with the rest of the teammates. Dante was used to shooting a lot of balls and not guarding anybody. He was so talented that in high school and in junior college, if he wanted to go get a shot, he could just go get a shot because he was talented enough to do that. He'd just jump over people and shoot the ball or jump over people and rebound the ball. Well, when he got here, there were other people talented also. So it took him a little time to adjust. And it took Dante some time to adjust to me and my demands about trying to guard people. But once he figured it out and once the team learned their roles and accepted their roles, we started playing really well. And it was sometime mid-January. The team really started playing well, and from that point on, I knew we had a chance to be a special basketball team.
Mild-mannered Eric Dampier. I remember him hardly talking.
Defense was the key. We really came out, we played hard first half, and after halftime, we were focused and said that we were going to go out and play like we did the first half.
He's soft-spoken to begin with, and he was that way his whole career.
I remember going to the press conference where it was really funny. They had the three players up there, and they kept asking them whether they could match up physically.
And Eric Dampier, who's a man of few words, he finally had enough of it, and he looked at him. He said, "Look, we lift weights at Mississippi State too."
And that's all he said. That was typical. He was the silent giant on the ball club. He didn't talk a lot.
What most people see of Eric is that big guy on the court that has the mask on all the time, that never shows any emotion. Certainly as a basketball player, he has tremendous strength and athletic ability for his size and a great defensive player. But off the court, he's kind of a fun-loving guy. He jokes around with all of the other players. He has some mischief about him. He picks at the coaches in a very subtle sort of way. So he's a much different personality than most of our fans perceive him to be.
Your sophomore point guard, Marcus Bullard.
One of the toughest, strongest players that I've ever coached, but off the court, one of the most sensitive young men I've ever been around. And I'm not sure many people get to see that side of Marcus.
To me, the core of that team in terms of defense, specifically defense, was Marcus Bullard at point guard. He was suffocating on defense.
Bullard was my favorite player on that team because I knew the background that he had come from. And I thought at that point in time, he was making a strong effort to leave the past that he had come from behind. And he was so tough out there on the floor. He wanted to guard the other team's best player. He wanted to do the dirty work. He wanted to sacrifice his game for the betterment of his team. And also, I thought he was the person that made sure he got the most out of his talent. And so I was a huge admirer. You know, when you would come early to the games, it was Bullard who was out there first shooting buckets before everybody else came out there. He worked incredibly hard. So I was a big fan.
Most of the players at this level, they're the best player on their high school team most of the time, which means they're the leading scorer on their high school team. Russell Walters, for instance, who doesn't get a lot of publicity on that 96 team, the Final Four team. Russell Walters, probably, other than maybe Dante, was the most highly recruited player on that team. Russell's role on our team was to defend, to rebound, and to be a screener, to get Darryl Wilson open, basically. And it took Russell a while to accept that role. He and I had some battles. We'd go round and round sometimes about it because he wasn't getting to shoot balls very much, and he was used to shooting. He had been a really good high school player.
Russell's pretty much what you see on the court, an intense, tough, physical player, a very sensitive young man, a guy who has taken his game this year and put aside personal statistics and personal glory for the good of the team.
And so Russell and Dante and Marcus Bullard, who was a big-time scorer in high school, very seldom shot the ball for us.
We all bought in, and that's the most important thing. You have to buy in to what your coach is looking for, the strength of your team. And I think we did an outstanding job of that.
And we were all excited about getting to go back to Rupp Arena because we were very familiar with that venue and felt like we'd have some fans there.
I mean, we knew there was something special going to happen if we just believed in the system and believed in each other.
Joining us now is WCBI Sports Director Mark Rogers. And Mark has been up in the cold weather, sometimes snow, sometimes sleet in Lexington, but it looks like you have a pretty day up there now, Mark.
There's no other place like Rupp Arena. So for me personally, to go to Rupp Arena, the mecca of college basketball, Kentucky basketball, and I know the Bulldogs felt right at home.
They are the underdog, but they feel good because nobody expects them to win, but they definitely know they can win.
Everybody on that team, we never looked at it as underdogs. We looked at it as we put our socks on like you put your socks on. We put your shoes on the same way.
I think when you say decided underdog, that implies a big underdog, and I don't think we'll be that. I think UConn will certainly be the favorite, but a decided underdog, I would take exception to that.
We had matchups with Cincinnati and UConn. UConn came first. We thought UConn was awfully good. I think they were really good. It was a good ball game. Ray Allen was a great guard that they had. Jim Calhoun was a great Hall of Fame coach.
Ray Allen was on that team. You're talking about a future basketball Hall of Famer playing on that team, and he was just fabulous. But the Bulldogs really clamped down on him. Marcus Bullard was all over him.
Ray Allen really trying to score, isn't he? Oh, Mississippi State with just two team fouls. And lost control of it. Now Bullard. All he's doing is looking at that number 34 right in the chest. Look at those eyes. Yep. See that?
Another thing when we played Connecticut is Darryl Wilson making all those three-point shots.
Three-point shots. How many are up?
Six.
Jones comes to Darryl Wilson, who fires for three. He's got it again. Wilson gets his sixth three of the afternoon, and the Bulldogs take the 13-point lead.
Russell and Eric were setting that a double screen for him. He was coming off those screens just making everything he shot.
The defense was stifling. They were tenacious. They were nasty. And UConn was suffocated in that game. And that's where I got a first dose of how good this team actually could be against the top teams in the country.
It's the Sweet 16 game when State played UConn on a Friday night. I was here manning the fort at the station. Jackie Sherrill was signing books in Lee Mall. And so in the first half, he's signing books, and the game was on in the corner, and people had, you know, one eye on Jackie and one eye on the game. But as the game went along, Coach Sherrill stopped signing books, and everybody kind of moved from the book signing line to the front of the TV. And so by the middle of the second half, you had 60 to 70 people in Lee Mall crowded around the TV with Jackie Sherrill right there watching MSU play UConn. And it was that kind of organic stuff that was happening anytime the Bulldogs played.
You know, the thing that I remember about that ball game is the fact that we just were solid. We would not let them win the ball game. I thought we just had great concentration and did things well in that game and just refused to lose that ball game to UConn.
Give it to Shepherd for the long jumper that is an air ball. Cleared out by Allen. He's going to pop up along with it. It's an air ball. Whit Hughes has the rebound for Mississippi State. You can wrap it in maroon and white. Well, the Bulldogs are going to be in the championship ball game of the Southeast Regional.
We really stepped up. We really were looking forward for that game. And it only helped that our big guy, Eric Dampier, he played 40 minutes that game, and he did a heck of a job that game. And I hit shots. Dante played big. Marcus played big. Russell did the things he was supposed to have done. The bench guys came in, that game was just, it was so exciting.
That was big.
I don't shake nobody's hand on it. I doubt.
That was big. But that's not what we came here for.
No way!
We came here to get two. You understand?
The Mississippi State basketball team made hoop history tonight. The Bulldogs defeated Connecticut in the third round of the NCAA tournament. Now it's on to the Elite Eight, farther than MSU has ever gone before. WCBI Sports Director Mark Rogers is live in Lexington with the Bulldogs.
Then they faced Cincinnati, and they were an underdog again as the two-seed Cincinnati came in, a big, bruising physical team. Bob Huggins exuded force and power. They physically intimidated teams.
The talk was how big Cincinnati was, how physical they were.
That was maybe my favorite game of the whole postseason was that ball game. Eric Dampier down on the baseline got a pass and made a two-step slam. It made a lot of the highlights. That was a big play.
Whit Hughes, who was a walk-on player on this team originally, he took a charge late in that game. One of the big guys from Cincinnati ran right over the top of him.
Takes it away.
Give it up, Long.
When Whit Hughes took that charge, Darrell Wilson came running down the floor and jumped right on top of Whit Hughes. Whit's still on the floor and Darrell's right on top of him in his face. They're both smiling because he knew what a big play that was. Here you have a white kid from a private school in Jackson, Mississippi, a small town black kid from Kennedy, Alabama, and all of a sudden, there they are, eyeball to eyeball, nose to nose, almost hugging each other. To me, that's the epitome of that 96 basketball team.
Give it up, take a lane, make something positive happen.
He flattened Hughes and perfect draw charge, and Dante Jones looking over to the Mississippi State fans.
Late in the game, we had a lead, and it was a fairly sizable lead, and Darrell Wilson, who was a great three-point shooter, but he didn't call this one. He banked one in from about 28 feet out, and when he did that, I looked over, and Bob Huggins was down on one knee, and but the game was over at that point. We knew we were going to win it.
68-59, Richard Williams' team inching closer, just 40 seconds away from a school first Final Four.
And what was amazing in that game is that Mississippi State didn't back down. They were actually the intimidator. They took the fight to Cincinnati and really dominated the basketball game, and Cincinnati really was never in it.
And Bart begins to dribble it and move it around, and Cincinnati's not going to chase it. This basketball game is over. Mississippi State's on the way to the Final Four with a 10-point win over the Cincinnati Bearcats, and their Bulldogs all in the center of Rupp Arena, hugging one another and double off the floor.
So there you have it. Does your bracket look like this at home? I'd love to see it if it does. UMass, Kentucky, Syracuse, and Mississippi State all get together next Saturday at the Meadowlands.
And the Bulldogs got the win, and it was just magical to win two games against two top teams, the 1 and 2 seeds, and do it at Rupp Arena.
But that was MSU's best game, and that was MSU's moment. And as that game went on, we were here at the station, and the phones were lighting up, and people started to come. People then started to congregate at GTR, waiting for them to come home. And that was when it just all got hyped for that homecoming at the airport.
There you see people outside, locked out of the Golden Triangle Airport. They had 2,000 people inside, and close to another 1,000 outside. Cars were all the way back to Highway 82. These people waited for about an hour to see their beloved Bulldogs get back from Lexington.
When we got back from Kentucky, from being Cincinnati, the airport was at capacity. People on the runway. All the way through, we had to have escorts to get through the airport. People were everywhere.
And I saw all kind of different people at that gathering, professors at MSU, teachers that had taught at Starkville High School, and they were all just going crazy. And I remember thinking, I was only 1 year out of college at the time, I'd never seen these adults act this way before, because they were giddy like children. It was great to see.
Just to be up in that atmosphere, to be a part of that, can't explain it. It was, like you said, it was like rock stars. We were the rock stars of Starkville in 1996.
Start to finish, there was no question that
this basketball team tonight was the best basketball team in the Southeast Regional. And as I told the New York media, I think it's one of the best four basketball teams in America. And we still have another weekend of basketball activity, and we're going to New York with the attitude that we can win the national championship.
What more can you say? Bulldog fever has struck the state of Mississippi. Allie?
Well, I'll tell you what, Chris, whether you're, you know, a Bulldog fan or Ole Miss fan or Alabama fan, you've got to be rooting for those Bulldogs, and we got our cowbells right here. There we go.
You know, they would always tell me, you need to relax, you need to have fun. I said, I'm having fun. This is what I do. It's all I do.
The Mississippi State basketball team left for New York City this afternoon. The Bulldogs play Syracuse Saturday in the Final Four. Now, Coach Richard Williams and his team arrived at Golden Triangle Airport to not quite the hype and hysteria that met the Bulldogs Sunday night after they returned from the Elite Eight. The crowds were small, and most of the players had their game faces on and weren't talking. But Sports 4 did chat with Coach Williams and Bart Heitch about the whole Final Four experience.
Well, you know, it's we're excited about going. It's great for our kids who've worked hard to reach this point, and we're looking forward to it. We hope we go up there and can represent everybody the way they need to be represented. Hope we can play well.
I learned more basketball from Richard Williams than just about anyone I can think of.
Yeah, I thought he was a brilliant X's and O coach. Great play caller, could get his players open looks all day long. Was extremely sound coaching them on defense. But just my personal opinion is he was an excellent coach, and he was an excellent coach for that team because he had a strong personality, and I think that's what it took to rein those guys in, because you had a lot of strong personalities on that team, and to get those guys to gel and play together and to play for him, I think was no small task. And so I'm not sure another person could have done it with that particular bunch.
Well, I don't think there's any question I was focused, and I was also passionate about it. And I would try to make the analogy, you know, if I'm going into surgery, I don't want that doctor laughing and joking and acting like he's having a ball. I want him serious. I want him focused on the task at hand. And that's the way I was as a coach. I was focused.
Some of you get the opinion that we're irritable, whiny, some of the adjectives I've seen. Well, let me give you some reasons why. Final Four caps says Mississippi on the back of it. Not Mississippi State, but Mississippi. So I think we have reason sometimes to be that way.
I'm not a psychologist. I'm a ball coach. That's what I do. I'm not a psychologist. You know, I don't get into all that stuff. You're going to have two teams, you're going to line up, and you're going to play.
So those boys from State, as they began to be called once they got to the Meadowlands at New York, was kind of a interesting phenomena because the other teams and the other coaches were so well known. But Mississippi State, they were the unknown team. They were the mystery team.
The Mississippi State basketball team is just about 16 hours away from the biggest game in school history. MSU takes on Syracuse tomorrow afternoon at 4:42 p.m. in the Final Four. Now, a game of that magnitude attracts plenty of media attention.
We actually, as media members, had national media coming up to us asking us about this Mississippi State basketball team, because if you really look at it, they were completely off the national radar until defeating Kentucky in the SEC championship game.
And I don't know, I think they realized suddenly where they were. If you've never played in a Final Four, you never had all that media attention. You had so much at the hotel. I mean, there was people all over the place. You begin to realize, I'm sure, what a big deal this is. And sometimes it's hard to relax and play. And this is a team, I think, that probably played best when they played a little bit more relaxed than maybe they were that day.
The thing I remember more than anything else is the media attention. Here in Starkville, we weren't in the media capital of the world, obviously. Those things can be distractions. And that's why I say many times now, I understand now if a coach can take his team back to the Final Four the second time, you have a much better understanding of the distractions you should take care of before you go.
Kentucky also arrived in town tonight. Rick Pitino's Wildcats refusing interviews until tomorrow's mandatory news conferences.
I didn't understand the distractions that we would have, in particular being in New York. You get off the bus and there's Mike Tirico from ESPN with a microphone in your face. And you all of a sudden you think, well, this is a pretty big deal. It's just something we've never experienced before. And it's just something you need to experience more than once to learn how to handle it.
Mississippi State arrived in New York an hour late tonight because of weather problems, but obviously glad to be here nonetheless, immediately swamped by reporters.
I think State tried to take steps to make their guys comfortable. For instance, one of the things they did, I understand, is they had Everett Kennard drive the team bus all the way from Starkville to New York City so they would be in their own bus, so they weren't renting a bus. And so I think they were trying to bring some sense of normalcy to the process, but when you go to the Final Four and you haven't been there before, and I think the key is when you're in New York City and you've got those kind of bright lights in big city, it was a tough adjustment.
Does this look like they can focus on basketball? You think that this many media people in Starkville? You must be kidding. You've never been there, right?
And arguably it showed in that game against Syracuse.
To win the national championship, you have to win 6 ball games. That means there's 2 left, and you wonder if the Bulldogs have 2 victories aside.
UMass had John Calipari and Marcus Camby, the player of the year. So despite not having a big historical basketball tradition, they were expected to be there. Syracuse, Jim Boeheim, basketball tradition, big power from the East. They were expected to be there. And of course, Kentucky was the best team in college basketball with Rick Pitino on the sideline. So they were expected to be there. But Mississippi State is a 5 seed, a team that struggled for the first half of the season, not expected to be there.
I remember this was always a ball club that cut up a lot. They were always joking around on the bus. And we drove out, we rode out to the arena with the team on the bus. I remember, and Jack Crilson and I always sat together. And team got off, and I remember I looked at Jack and I said, Jack, I don't like this. I said, they're just as quiet as they can be. I said, they're never quiet like this.
And we were in the tunnel getting ready to go on the floor before the Syracuse game. And I'll never forget, I looked at my assistants and I said, I think we could have a problem today. The team's attitude was different. It wasn't the same. They were not tight, but they were just bouncing up and down. And it wasn't the same just looseness ready to play that I had seen.
Oh, Syracuse game. Going in, we thought that there was no way they could play a zone the whole game against us and beat us. Because we were a threat. We had Eric down low. We had Russell doing his thing. Dante and I were playing really well at the moment. Marcus had just came around and hit his first three-point shot in against Cincinnati at Rupp. So we were feeling real good.
Sam Pierce surrounded, finds Jones. Jumper, got it, three-pointer. Wilson, three.
Forget it.
No call. Wilson, three-pointer. Third three-pointer already for Mississippi State.
When the game started, we jumped out real quick. I hit like two threes. Dante hit 2 threes. Marcus hit a 3. So we were feeling real good.
Out to Bullard. Bulldogs have a chance to run.
Big numbers here. Dampier coming.
Jones just lays it in beautiful. Mississippi State off to another big start.
But some point in time in that game, it's kind of shifted. Turnovers, bad decision, fouls.
There's that 2-3 zone of Syracuse.
Trying to lob it over the top of it to Jones. That Walters influenced that misfire by Wallace. That pass thrown away by Bullard. On the block, Dampier trying to get it over on a bounce to Jones.
I think you could see that in the way the game was played and the flow of the game. I saw State make mistakes in that game that they had not made in 2 months.
Boy, pulling everything back out, get his team settled down, and then has it turned over.
Yeah, Sims forced it.
I really don't know what happened at the Final Four. This team that was on a complete roll, so in sync, had defeated Kentucky, the best team in college basketball, coming off 2 consecutive wins over the 1 and 2 seeds, UConn and Cincinnati, suddenly looked really flat.
Jim, we're not seeing a lot of smiles on Jones's face. Quite a while.
Learned in and out from three-point land.
But it was a learned experience. It was a learned experience, and it's kind of hard to talk about that game. My son and I went back in. We watched that game, and when my first time watching it, it was kind of hard for me as a grown man who's played 9 years professional overseas. The mistakes I made at 21, to go back and watch it as a grown man, bad pass here, bad decision here. I should have shot that ball here. It's a learning process. So I learned, but it's a little too late.
And here comes a trap for the first time out of the zone.
Nice beat it. Walters lost control of it. Bullard is there. Look out, Savoy with the steal.
I don't know. Everybody can have their own idea of what happened, but they didn't play as well as they had played in the other games, particularly in that stretch down the stretch when they won the late season games and then won the conference tournament, played so well. They had played so well for so long, and this was not one of their best games.
Guys dribbling the ball off of their foot. Strange things happened in that game that just make that game a real anomaly. And so whether it was the pressure or the bright lights or just maybe the magic ended for that particular game at that particular time and nobody knows the reason why, but certainly there was something different that day.
They started much too early to go straight threes. At the 3-minute mark, they took desperation shots. Jones never went for that rebound.
Syracuse is going to be heading to Monday night's championship game.
They were throwing the ball all over the place, turnovers galore. Just didn't look in sync. We're getting beat to every spot on the floor, getting pushed around. And to credit Syracuse, sure, they won the game, but Mississippi State was never in the game, never really showed up for that game for whatever reason.
We fought back. I always thought we would come back just off what we all had on the inside, but that game, it didn't happen.
Well, it was a magical run for Mississippi State to the Final Four, but no retreat, no surrender, no excuse. Syracuse is going to the Monday night final. They count the three.
0.8 seconds up there. Mississippi State's going to let Wallace get it in, and Jones is going to shake hands with it.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dennis Sutton reporting live just outside the Humphrey Coliseum on the Mississippi State University campus. And those sirens you hear in the background are the Mississippi State Bulldogs announcing their arrival back to Starkville, Humphrey Coliseum, and the Golden Triangle area. We are outside the Humphrey Coliseum. Chris Latimer is inside with all of the details, where about 1,000 Bulldog fans are waiting to welcome their Mississippi State basketball team home.
The bus just pulled up. Talk about what kind of a year. An SEC Western Division championship, then an SEC tournament win over Kentucky, the team's first SEC tournament win ever, then big-time wins in the NCAA over VCU, Princeton, Cincinnati, UConn, and then now the Final Four. Didn't quite get it done there, but it's time to come home, and these Bulldog fans are excited.
I just remember the hype, and I think some teams capture the hearts of fans at a particular time more than others, and that Final Four team captured the heart of the MSU fan base.
It's been a great journey this year. It's been an exciting time for all of us. I know it's been an exciting time for all of you. We certainly appreciate all of you being here today. But more than that, we appreciate all of you that have been with us throughout this season. You can't imagine what it means to us. And just from the bottom of our hearts, we say thank you to the Mississippi State family.
This team, the 96 team, is celebrated as the best team in the history of Mississippi State. Now, whether it is or not, we don't know. It's hard to compare, but we do know they're the only team that ever went to the Final Four from the state of Mississippi. And so that event itself is such a huge deal. In particular, that year was in New York. It made it an even huger deal.
All the hard work, all the time together, in the hotel rooms, on the road, on the bus, practice, the blood, the sweat, it was all worth it.
Every year, as a young high school basketball player, if you have dreams of going on to play college basketball, your dream is to play in the Final Four. I know it was mine. I know that my teammates, it was theirs. We would love the game. We were very passionate about it.
A lot of people dream of going there. Very few get the opportunity to go, and I'm so happy for this basketball team and this coaching staff, but more so than anything, happy for the Mississippi State family, because tonight's one of our brightest stars.
And I think Richard Williams took pride in that. I mean, he always would want to recruit Mississippi players, and he always made a point that his guys were homegrown and Mississippi guys or rural Alabama guys.
Just something special about those guys, about that team, a family that we had a bigger belief.
You just try to take it in, and
I think when it was over, it kind of started sinking in.
I'm glad to be a part of a group of seniors that I've been around and people I've been around for 3 years. Daryl, it's good to play with people that have a lot of heart and a lot of pride. And she feel like you can go out every night and you know they're going to give their best effort and you're going to give your best effort. I feel real proud about playing for Mississippi State, and I think it's the best accomplishment of my life, so that pretty well wraps it up.
And they look back and they say, Coach, I can't believe how fast it went.
Basketball's not for everybody. If you don't have it, it's on the inside, you're not going to succeed. You got to want to. But if you stay strong, you put the time in, and you work hard, who knows? These little small town kids now could be like small town kids on my Final Four team.
Even now, 20 years later, not even a week goes by without some stranger, quite honestly, wanting to talk about the Final Four and their memories from that year or a particular game. And these aren't all Mississippi State people. And these really aren't all Mississippians. These are people from all over the country that just identified with that team and remembered that year and what a special run we had.
I think the fact that it had some really outstanding players, that people at that time really were able to identify with, and a lot of people loved Darryl Wilson, people loved Eric Dampier, people loved Dante Jones. So those kind of things. And the fact that I think Mississippi State was hungry for something like that to happen.
I think that's the key. I think that was the first time that state fans believed that they were going to win a national championship. Because, you know, since then, you've had the baseball team play for a national title in Omaha, and you've had the football team be ranked number one for an extended period of time in football. The basketball team started all of that. The basketball team, I think, gave Mississippi State fans and that athletic program the realization that they can accomplish great things.
I think this team deserves the recognition of maybe the greatest team in the history of Mississippi State.
Look what we accomplished. It's amazing. Thank you.